In the Foundations 2 tutorial, we talked about chemical bonding. In this tutorial, we'll look at how to draw molecules, which are made up of bonds. Remember from the Foundations 2 tutorial that covalent bonds, whether polar or nonpolar, are represented by a line between two atoms. For example, we draw water like this, which is an oxygen atom covalently bonded to two hydrogen atoms. And we draw methane like this, which is a carbon atom covalently bonded to four hydrogen atoms. Most molecules that we talk about in biology consist mostly of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen atoms. For example, ethanol, which is drinking alcohol, is made up of two carbons, six hydrogens, and one oxygen, all covalently bonded together like this. Molecules are three-dimensional, but we draw them in two dimensions. To deal with this and to show three-dimensionality, we use solid lines to indicate atoms that come out of the page, and dashed lines to indicate atoms that project back into the page. In ethanol, these two hydrogen atoms come out of the page, and these two go back into the page. Because covalent bonds between carbon and hydrogen are so common in molecules, chemists use shorthand to simplify how the molecule is drawn. Instead of writing out all the carbon atoms, we can draw ethanol like this, indicating where the oxygen atom is, but using corners to indicate where the carbon atoms are. The hydrogen atoms that are covalently bonded to the carbon atoms are implied. Remember that carbon has four electrons in its valence electron shell, so carbon needs four more electrons to have a full valence shell. Here's the Lewis dot structure of carbon. Carbon can get those electrons by sharing electrons with other atoms, which forms covalent bonds. Remember that a single covalent bond is formed when each atom shares one of its own electrons, and this would provide carbon with one more electron that counts toward its valence shell. Carbon could have four single covalent bonds and have a full valence shell. A double bond is formed when each atom shares two of its own electrons, and this would provide carbon with two more electrons that count toward its valence shell. Carbon could have two double bonds and have a full valence shell. Any combination of single, double, and triple bonds that results in four extra electrons shared with carbon fills carbon's valence shell. How can we tell what combination of covalent bonds this carbon atom has to fill its shell? In this representation, the hydrogen atoms are the only atoms that are implied. Hydrogen only has one electron, which means it can only contribute one electron and thus only form single covalent bonds. When you see a molecule drawn like this, you can assume that the carbon atoms are bonded to enough hydrogen atoms to make four covalent bonds, filling carbon's valence electron shell. This carbon has one single bond to the neighboring carbon and must have three more covalent bonds, so there are three hydrogens attached to it. And this carbon has two single covalent bonds, one to that first carbon and one to the oxygen atom, so it has two more covalent bonds to hydrogen. Another shortcut is to write atoms next to each other instead of drawing lines between them. This can indicate either a covalent bond or an ionic bond, depending on what the two atoms are. For example, the covalent bond between oxygen and hydrogen can simply be written OH. Another example of this type of drawing is glucose, which is a sugar. Glucose is made of 6 carbons, 12 hydrogens, and 6 oxygens, all covalently bonded together. Glucose can exist in two forms, in a linear or open chain form, which looks like this, or bonded together into a ring, which looks like this. Notice that in the open chain form, all the intersections between lines indicate carbon atoms. In the ring form, the corners indicate carbon atoms. At this corner, which is a carbon atom, only two of the covalent bonds are explicitly drawn. The other two hydrogen atoms that are covalently bonded to this carbon are implied. Here's a 3D image of glucose, showing that the bottom part of the ring is projecting out of the page. We can also draw the ring form without explicitly drawing any of the hydrogen atoms. These representations are totally equivalent. There are other ways to view molecules that more closely represent what they actually look like. Think back to Foundation 1. The structure of a given atom can be approximated as a sphere because the electron cloud around an atom is close to spherical. So we can draw molecules with a ball and stick representation, which shows the atoms as colored balls and uses sticks to show bonds between those atoms. Each type of atom is a different color. In these ball and stick representations of glucose, carbon is black, oxygen is red, and hydrogen is gray. However, covalent bonds don't really look like sticks. The atoms that form a covalent bond are sharing electrons, and those shared electrons belong to both electron clouds. So instead of drawing a stick between the atoms, it's more accurate to draw intersecting spheres to show that the electron clouds of the two atoms intersect. This is done with a space-filling model. This representation is a much more accurate image of what molecules look like. For most molecules, there's very little, if any, empty space between atoms. However, this representation makes it much more difficult to see the individual atoms that make up glucose, so it's often easier to use a different representation. Many biological molecules are very large, and sometimes all of these representations are too detailed for what we're interested in. For example, here's a detailed drawing of a segment of DNA, showing many of the atoms involved. But this is only a very small segment of a long strand of DNA. Here's a ball and stick model of DNA. Notice that only this segment of a DNA strand is seen in that detailed drawing. A space-filling model shows how close together all the atoms are. But maybe we're more interested in the overall shape rather than the individual atoms that make up DNA. In that case, we might use a cartoon diagram. A cartoon diagram uses lines and ribbons to represent the different segments of DNA. This helps us see the overall shape of the molecule, but it sacrifices some detail. Cartoon diagrams are commonly used with big molecules such as DNA and proteins. An example of a protein we might want to represent is hexokinase. Hexokinase is an enzyme that is involved in cell metabolism. Here's a small segment of hexokinase showing some of the atoms involved. This segment makes up only about 0.3% of the entire protein. You can imagine how overwhelming an entire picture of hexokinase would be if a representation with this much detail were used. A ball and stick model of hexokinase keeps the identity of the atoms that make up the protein. A space-filling model is great for showing the overall shape of the protein. Finally, a cartoon model shows the general outline of the protein, including how it folds onto itself. As you can see, there are various ways to represent molecules, and each representation has its strengths. Choosing an appropriate representation depends on what you want to highlight or what aspect of a molecule you're most interested in. Keep in mind that for a given molecule, all these representations are showing the same atoms bonded together in the same way.